is the legacy of Mike Tyson. Possessed with one of the most devastating knockout punches in the history of the sport, this incredible specimen of boxing talent has, in a few short years, risen from the daily struggle for survival to the elite class of the world's greatest champions. He is a superstar of the 80s whose records are at the top of the charts. These are Mike Tyson's greatest hits.
Hello, I'm Mike Tyson. Those of you who followed my boxing career know I've accomplished a lot in a short period of time. It happened way back in 1980 when I first met Customato, the world-famous trainer and manager.
After training such great champions as Floyd Patterson and Jose Torres, Customato opened a small gym above a police station in upstate New York, leaving the world of big-time boxing behind. Until he met a 13-year-old delinquent from Brooklyn, brought to him from a nearby penal institution. Cuss knew if he would dig deep enough with this troubled youth, he would uncover a jewel.
Right, back and forth like this.
Okay. I'm not a creator. What I do is discover and uncover. See, my job is to take the spark and fan it. When it starts to become a little flame, I feed it. And I feed the fire until it becomes a roaring blaze. And then when it comes a roaring blaze, I pour huge logs on. And then you really got a fire going.
He had taught many boys the sweet science, sharing his large home in Catskill with them. But one boy in particular stood out not only in the ring, but in Cuss's heart.
When I was 14, Cuss used to tell me about all this. We talk about the old fighters or something, and then we go to another hour, we talk about girls. It was just like my big brother, of my father, talking about my father.
Within 2 years of their meeting, the old professor legally adopted his rising star. Their destiny had begun.
And Cuss always strived. He said, you could be the champ, even at a young age. And I believed in him. I developed that kind of confidence in him. And we just made it, that was the destiny, no matter whatever happened. And he discussed times that he wasn't feeling well and he doesn't think he's going to be around. But he said, no matter what, the job must go on.
Guided by the teachings of the master, Mike Tyson set about changing his life, and in time, the entire boxing world.
But you aim it here and bring the same hand. When he hits here, he's liable to bring it down. Even if he's got his life, bring it down, bang, over here, bang, with the left hook here or here. And you get hit, bang, you get excited and your head comes up your hands. When you get hit, that's when you gotta be calmest. You gotta be clever, you gotta be smart, and not get hit. And when you're able to do this, you're a fighter.
As a fighter, Tyson first entered the amateur ranks. His impact was immediately felt. After a successful amateur career, Mike Tyson now stepped into the ring as a professional. It was a new game for the 18-year-old. He would be up against stronger, more mature competition. But he had trained for this moment, and he had learned his lessons well. As he had been taught, he was putting on a great show. But as his reputation grew, so did his impatience for bigger stakes. The results were now all too familiar to the men who faced him. He fought like a seasoned veteran, stalking his opponents, choosing his punches well. He could mix it up, exchanging combinations, and then pick a target, punishing the body. And if they made the mistake of getting up for more, launch a cannon to the head. Compact, quick, and incredibly powerful, he fine-tuned his knockout punch. His confidence soared. With Customato's guidance, Mike had gained the respect of the public and his peers. In the ring, he had conquered his fear. But now there was an even greater challenge. And this time, he had to face it alone. On November 4th, 1985, just 3 days after Mike Tyson knocked out his 11th straight professional opponent, Customato died of pneumonia. Though the master was gone, his voice still echoed in the gym he called home.
Your mind is not in your way. There's something distracting you. And remember, it's always good to throw the punch where you could hit him and he can't hit you. That's what the science of boxing is all about.
The master instilled in the student his experiences and thoughts to carry him through his journey. Words were his tools, words that are still very much alive today.
You know what I like about it? It's about the coward and the hero, that both of them feel the same.
It's what they do that makes them different. In other words, the hero feels just as frightened as the coward.
But it's just that the coward, he runs instead of the hero, he feels the same, and he has the discipline, and he just makes himself go through whatever has to be done.
It's what he does that makes him a hero, and what the other fellow doesn't do that makes him a coward.
It was D'Amato's philosophy to build will rather than skill. With Mike, he had succeeded. He had bred in Tyson the heart of a champion, a heart that had other feelings as well.
You know, it really is difficult because I did miss him a lot. But even besides, before when Cuss was around, I was always that way. I used to always keep things to myself. But it's just that I let some things out. I spoke to him about some things that were on my mind. But when things get on my mind now, I don't talk to anyone about it. If Cuss was around, he would tell me things. And he would explain, this is what I would do. And so I would tell him, yes. But just don't worry about it, because everything's going to be all right. And he knew not to worry about it. There's no way we could fail. We must succeed.
Determined not to fail the memory of his beloved tutor, Mike returned to the ring with a vengeance. Immediately setting a course on the road to the heavyweight title. A passion for victory exploded in enormous blows. The pace accelerated as he met each new challenge head-on, steamrolling through the middle ranks of the heavyweight division, throwing some of the best punches many had ever seen, and some not even seen at all. During the last 10 months of 1985, in his first year as a pro, Mike Tyson had knocked out all 15 of his opponents. And with the new year, the hits just kept on coming. Even when pushed into the middle rounds of a bout, he could unleash unbelievable combinations. Now reaching the critical point in his career, there was little need for worry. Mike Tyson had been properly prepared. His new co-managers had built the foundation along with Customato by providing lessons on all the great old fighters from their extensive boxing library. At this stage, the late Jim Jacobs and partner Bill Caton developed Mike's progress.
Our chief responsibility has been, over the last year, to pick the opponents for Mike Tyson. Nothing is more important than the opponents you pick for a fighter.
The strategy was set to showcase Tyson at his best.
When someone sees a Mike Tyson fight, we want them to leave the arena saying, when can we go see him again?
We decided the time was at hand for the marketing of Mike with a technique that had never been used before, simply because video cassettes were never really available to a manager before. We prepared cassettes of all of Mike's fights and sent those cassettes with a covering letter to the top sports writers and top television personalities throughout the country.
For Mike Tyson, the value of the press has been priceless, as one of boxing's most respected writers can attest.
The press plays a very big part in the sense that if a promoter or manager knows how to use the press, you get the amount of ink, the timing of the ink, in such a way that getting a title shot pays. Anybody can get a title shot if you want to pay for it. The idea is to get the title shot so it pays you.
That meant generous contracts, both from network television and a long-term deal with HBO.
I don't believe there's ever been a fighter who has reached this prominence this quickly in the history of boxing.
Yet, as the center of all this attention, Mike, like the pigeons he raised, sometimes wished he could just fly away.
But can I tell you something? People wouldn't want to be in my shoes. They really think so because they say, wow, I can make money, I can get rich. But if they had to go through some of the things I had to go through, I think they would cry. Sometimes it's so depressing you got to go through. Like, everybody's always, they always want something. They want to find a way to get your money. It's always people just as hard as you work in a gym, there's people working that hard to separate you from your money. I'm doing my job 100%, and I expect them to do their job 100%. The result is a foregone conclusion. There's no way we could fail.
The next step would be a network television debut in front of a partisan home crowd. Tyson was aggressive but wary, measuring his opponent through five rounds. There was some question about his stamina until he punctuated the answer with a swift uppercut. Ferguson barely held on until disqualified for staying too often in the clinch. Mike Tyson had staged an impressive first effort for a rapidly growing number of fans. Nationally recognized as a legitimate title contender, this gladiator proudly displayed his trademark, black trunks, no socks, no robe. Now he would meet boxing's best, fighters with broad experience who knew how to neutralize his attack. Tyson worked with his other skills, patiently waiting for his moment. This was a tougher breed of boxer than he was used to, and despite the victories, it was hard for him to control his frustration. Now, when he entered the ring, his opponents already had the book on Mike Tyson.
You understand? Throw the 1-2 from the outside and tie him up. 1-2, tie him up. Don't fight him inside. Get him on the outside.
Green just trying to tie Tyson up, and a couple of good shots by Mitch Green. His best rally of the fight right here.
Look here.
He's caught Tyson 4 or 5 times, and Tyson for the first time seems a little bit puzzled.
Well, he's smiling. Tyson is smiling, but see, Green has those fast hands.
Tyson said one time, he said, I understand anatomy.
Here again.
Oh, what a left hand.
Tyson enjoyed silencing his critics with another win.
And going 10 rounds, I'm telling you, it's fun. I'm having a good time in there.
And the fun continued, but not for the men who chose to step into the ring with Mike Tyson. Theirs was a different fate. One that came all too swiftly. Once again, the look of a devastating knockout puncher returned. Still, his critics wondered if Mike Tyson could hold his own against the big heavyweights, the ones who could take a punch and come back for more.
Goes and Tyson is on top of him. Ribalta ties him up. We've still got a long way to go in this eighth round, halfway. There's a big right hand, and Ribalta is about to go. Ties him up again, showing a lot of moxie. Oh, what a shot! And Ribalta is down. is up, but he is in some trouble.
Oh, he's seriously hurt this time, though.
Hey, how you doing? You want to continue?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Okay.
Oh, so do you want to continue? He said, yeah, hell yeah. That's a fighter. And that's it.
With another knockout in his next fight, he had completed all the lessons. Mike Tyson was ready to graduate.
Now I was ready to challenge for the heavyweight title. A lifelong dream was about to come true. The only person standing in my way of the title was Trevor Burbick.
After defeating Pinklin Thomas for the WBC title 8 months earlier, Trevor Burbick was determined to keep his prize. But someone else had other ideas. Despite some impressive measurements of his own, Tyson gave up a distinct height and reach advantage to the champion. In the ring, however, he measures things differently.
To my advantage, because most fighters are used to fighting opponents 6'3", 6'2", the average heavyweight. And I feel that I use it to my advantage because I move my head, I'm very quick, and I'm low to the ground, and it's very difficult to hit me. I get a lot of leverage for my punches. And it doesn't matter if I punch up or straight or down or around, I have good leverage. Jabbing is all to do with timing. If you throw your jab at the right time, you could be 5'6", and I'll jab a guy 6'4". When I was younger, I used to always say, God, I'm just a midget. I'm never going to grow. I'm never going to be anything because I'm too short to do any kind of sports, anything. But then, you know, I mean, I started believing in myself, and things worked out right.
And the way things worked out brought him here.
This is the main event of the night. 12 rounds of boxing for the WBC Championship of the World.
At age 20 years, 4 months, and 22 days, Mike Tyson could, with this win, become the youngest heavyweight champion ever, surpassing the record of Floyd Patterson.
The key in this fight for Tyson is to be patiently aggressive, not to fling himself into clinches as he has done. The key for Burbick, in my judgment, is to hold him off and smother Tyson and hope for a long fight that wears him out.
Then he can be in the hunt.
Well, what is, I feel, is imperative for both fighters, keep those hands hot.
Both wearing black, Burbick with the high black stockings. Left hook, Tyson.
What's Burbick's trying to do? He's trying to overpower Mike Tyson. And he's abandoning doing what he normally does best, and that is to use his whole body, to use those broad shoulders.
That was a big right hand by Tyson. This crowd is right into this fight, right at the bell.
I would not be surprised when these guys go down because they're throwing big shots and both fighters are a little cold, a little stiff here. A little tight.
Right hand, Tyson, and a left behind it. Burbick, as he told us he would, trying to go to the uppercut so far ineffectively. Big right hand.
Tyson has to be patient, as Laurie stated, because he's fighting a guy that's been in the ring with top caliber fighters. So he knows how to get a breather, get that second wind going.
Another big left hook by Tyson. I mentioned this earlier, but Tyson's punches even sound different than most heavyweights.
That was an attempt at the uppercut by Mike Tyson. It wasn't a clean shot. Trevor appears to be trying to keep Tyson backing up, making him fight his fight.
Another good left hand by Tyson, and a right behind it, and Burbick is rocked.
Burbick in trouble here. Burbick just trying to get through the round. He's hurt, no question.
That was a big, big round for Mike Tyson, not only because he showed he had faster hands and beat Burbick to the punch, but because he did show the patient aggressiveness that we talked about earlier. We have to remember that Trevor Burbick has never been hit by punches as hard as he's being hit in this fight, and you'd never know how a man is going to respond to that. Tyson is everything that people could have hoped for in that round.
Trevor Burbick, we should point out, has been down twice. There's another big shot by Tyson. Burbick in a heap of trouble. Down he goes.
The punches are coming in such a succession that Burbick can't deal with them. They're short, powerful, devastating punches.
Is still hurt. Trevor Burbick still seems to be not on solid legs at all here, Ray.
Well, again, you notice that my man is being patient. Tyson is being very, very patient, which was a big concern from a lot of other boxing people. He's being patient against a guy that has a great deal of experience. He's not wasting any punches.
Trying to tie Mike Tyson up here, just kind of hang on and get the cobwebs out. Oh, another big right hand, and Burbick is in trouble again.
Tyson is perpetual motion, and the reason he's so dangerous, Burbick, because he continues to throw his punches. One thing I've noticed in Tyson, he actually turns southpaw because he can knock you out with either hand. He has good leverage because he keeps his balance.
He missed with that uppercut, but didn't miss by much. Was a right to the body and an uppercut to the head, and Burbick is down. This one is going to be over, I believe. It's over. That's all, and we have a new era in boxing.
See, we understand the punching power of Mike Tyson. All you have to do is watch this replay, and Trevor Burbick has a very durable chin. He has never been hit that hard, that often, by any fighter.
Just tremendous shots and very quick hand speed. He set up the last knockdown with a shot to the body and came right back behind it. And you could see at this point that Trevor Burbick was not about to get back up.
Mike Tyson did what Mike Tyson normally does, and that's fight.
Yeah, and he does. That's with a capital F also.
His mark was written in boxing history. Mike Tyson had become the youngest heavyweight ever to be called champion. After a well-deserved rest, the new champ brought his crown jewel into the next step of the heavyweight unification series. This time, the prize was Bone Crusher Smith's WBA title.
The first right hand by Smith, nowhere near its mark.
It's also a straight right hand, and Smith will often come from right to left. There was a body shot. That was not a punch. That was not a punch.
Tyson got off the floor and looked at Smith with disdain, as if to say, are you kidding me? You think that's a punch?
Maybe his game plan, well, he thinks you're going to get tied. Maybe just show him that you ain't going to get tied. You understand? Spit it out.
Tyson is trying everything he can to try to get in one good punch.
That was a right hand by Smith. That actually backed Tyson up.
That was the best punch of the fight. We thought we would see that in the first 10 seconds, not in the last 10 seconds.
And it is over.
It was too late, it was too little for Bone Crusher Smith.
With this victory came Tyson's second heavyweight title. Pinklin Thomas, once holding a crown of his own, would be next to try and dethrone boxing's newest prince. But against this man, first, he would have to survive.
Will self-preservation kick in for Thomas, or will he come out trying to win this fight?
Took a deep breath before the opening bell. Not a bad idea against Mike Tyson.
Tyson is a 6-1 favorite.
Tyson starts out with the right hand.
Well, you notice there's a much more aggressive Mike Tyson than there was with Bone Crusher Smith. You notice that what happens inside here, we see some clinching. That's what exactly Bone Crusher Smith did. But inside, you may see that Mike Tyson still works. He still throws punches.
He's not giving Thomas a chance to unload that jab.
What Angelo Dundee wants Pinklin Thomas to do is give him angles. Don't stand directly in front of Mike Tyson, because you see here, Mike can throw punches from either angle and with a lot of power.
Yeah, Dundee said Tyson is a two-beat fighter. What he means by that is he comes in, he feigns left, he feigns right. There's a big left hand by Tyson, but Thomas is all right.
You know why Tyson's able to nail so many guys is because he doesn't throw one or two punches. He throws a series of combinations, and one of those punches is going to land. The left hook there. Beautiful left hook.
He has just not let Thomas uncork the jab. He's on top of him before Thomas could let the jab go.
Well, I stated earlier, the key to this punch for Pinklin Thomas is a jab. He has not thrown the left jab to keep his man off balance. You see that it breaks your rhythm. The jab breaks the rhythm.
Another big left hand. Thomas is hurt. 50 seconds left in a round. Long way.
There's the uppercut.
And a big left hand right on the jaw of Pinklin Thomas. Thomas is in all kinds of trouble. Still 30 seconds to go in the round.
You see that jab? You see, again, it keeps him off balance.
And now
makes him reach.
It's also started to go side to side pretty well, too.
That jab, as long as you use it consistently, it will keep anyone off balance. It'll make you reach in, the right hand will land.
Step up.
And you'll find it'd be a much easier fight.
Pinklin Thomas really is almost starting to control the tempo of the fight. Tyson is almost fighting Thomas's fight rather than the opposite. And I've never seen that happen. Thomas is holding him a little bit.
I'm waiting to see Mike Tyson throw that bolo punch, kind of bolo, double right hand. Right hand to the body and right hand to the head.
That's another round for Pinklin Thomas, in my book.
Bad intentions, baby.
What's the matter?
You're getting tired.
He's getting tired.
Yeah, we got
something has happened to Pinklin Thomas's glove.
Yeah, we got
and we wonder now what's happening here, whether he thinks Thomas is tired and he's done something. Remember the famous incident with the cut glove of Muhammad Ali when he fought Henry Cooper. You also remember early in this round that Mike Tyson commented to his corner that he thought Thomas was getting tired. So I'm just wondering whether Angelo is pulling something right here.
And a left hand, and that staggered Thomas. And a right hand behind it. Thomas in trouble again. And now Tyson moves in for the kill. Two uppercuts and a left hand.
Thomas trying to hold on. Serious trouble, and down he goes. It's over. It is over. Thomas did not make it by the count of 10.
You heard in the corner before that round, Kevin Rooney saying, start throwing punches with mean intentions. In effect, he was saying, can those jabs I've been telling you to throw for the first five rounds and start throwing some real punches. And when he did, he did.
This convincing victory led to the culmination of the 18-month-long series to determine the undisputed heavyweight champion of the world. In the final event, Tony Tucker matched his IBF crown against Tyson's WBA-WBC titles.
I was expecting Mike Tyson to jump right on Tony Tucker. Tucker, I had figured that he should at least tie his man up, try to frustrate Mike Tyson.
But is he strong enough to do that?
Well,
that was a good right hand by Tucker. That might have been the best shot that Mike Tyson has ever taken right there.
Did you notice that uppercut rocked Mike Tyson? This man, Tucker, may have found out a weakness. He may have seen something. Technically speaking, no one gave Tucker a chance. But there are miracles here.
The last time Tony Tucker lost a fight was in 1978.
You know, a lot of times people say, well, what do you see in Mike Tyson? And we always felt that he was susceptible to take jabs, but I think what Tucker saw in Tyson was the uppercut. He was susceptible to the uppercut because of his style, the way he launches in.
That was one of the few times I have ever seen Mike Tyson stopped by a punch. Again, a right hand, but he took a right from Tyson. And another big right by Mike Tyson. Did a very good first round for both men, and particularly for Tucker. There's a great left hand at the bell by Tyson.
Well, Tony Tucker is a 10-1 underdog. He wasn't 10-1 in that round.
Just like that in the end, you start to pick it up a little bit. You gotta come alive a little bit. You understand me? Yeah, I understand. Run up to the head. Don't look for the one shot to the head. Go to the body. Body first.
Now let's see the uppercut almost immediately after the bell. He follows a right with a left and rocks Tyson. The first time we've ever seen Tyson really rock back like that.
There was a good right hand again by Tucker. In close, catching Tyson on the way in.
He's finished with the left hook, Barry.
Let's get back, let's get back.
Crowd booing the tactics of Tony Tucker, but I'm not sure, you don't disagree with those
I don't
tactics.
Disagree at all, because Tony's been tying his man up.
There was a good right hand by Tucker again.
But they're uppercuts, Barry. Do you notice they're uppercuts? Again, he's tying his man up. Frustration should show the face of Mike Tyson.
There has to be concern now in Tyson's corner. This is the most competitive fight he has ever been in.
He's going one punch at a time. He makes you miss it, then he pops you one time. You understand?
You got to take the knee. Take the initiative. When you hit him to the fight, push him off. Don't grab him. Push him off and attack him.
But through the middle rounds, the attack faded, and Tyson's time had come.
There was a big left hand. Tucker says, no. Finishing with a flourish. And so is Tucker. Great finish to a pretty entertaining evening. It's over.
Well, Tony Tucker talked the talk and walked the walk.
And Mike Tyson walked now with three championship belts, the first undisputed heavyweight champion since Leon Spinks, beat Muhammad Ali. But Tyrell Biggs was one man that many thought might have the right stuff to strip the champion of his crown.
Three questions that Mike Tyson really has to answer. Can he cope with a clever boxer? Can he survive a heavy puncher? And can he persevere when he's hurt?
You notice right from the start, Tyson is applying the pressure, trying to slow his man down. I'm seeing more jabs from Mike Tyson than I've seen in the past. I see a lot of movement on the part of Tyrell Biggs. Good lateral movement. Those hands should be up a little higher because, again, the hand speed of Mike Tyson is very good.
You have said that Biggs has to go side to side to win the fight, right?
Go side to side, give your man angles, throw the jab like he's doing now, not to let Tyson set up.
Tyson also said that he has found a pattern in Tyrell Biggs that he feints to the right before the punch actually is thrown.
Well, whatever he does, the fact that Tyson has to set up to get that kind of leverage. See, a good snapping jab is very effective. Whether or not Biggs can keep this up is yet to be seen.
And now the cut over the left eye, and it's pretty bad.
It's the same eye, the same cut.
And another big left hand, and Biggs is hurt.
That six was beautiful. Let's see, 6-5-1. 6-5-2-1.
Oh, come on, this guy's gone.
Now listen,
come
to
on, you're better fighting him.
Fire from your chin, though. The guy can't fight inside. So if you got no legs, fight him inside if you got.
Those numbers you heard were a fight combination. Customato, the mentor of Mike Tyson, used to put numbers on the different fight combinations, and Kevin Rooney is Tyson's disciple.
I heard something interesting in Big's corner. His trainer said, if your legs are gone, stand and fight him. Stand toe-to-toe and fight him. So apparently the legs of Tyrell Biggs are shot. That was
a tremendous left hand.
Four, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. How do you feel, okay?
Oh, this is it.
He is gone right now. He has no legs at all. And 10 seconds to go in a round. There's a left hand. He's down again. It's over. It's all over. And it wasn't even close. Here's the final knockdown now.
I think it's the power and the fact that Mike Tyson actually wore his man down.
It seemed no ordinary man could beat Mike Tyson, but next, he had to face a legend.
After the big fight, there was a new challenge. Larry Holmes, who was champion for 7.5 years until Spinks beat him in 1985, now it was my turn and my era.
For this newest opponent, Tyson stuck to the same old game plan that had brought such great success before, one that included a great measure of sacrifice.
No one wants to get up at 4 and run when it's pitch dark. It has to be done. And the only reason I do it so early is because I believe that the other guy isn't doing it, and that it gives me a little edge. But the most difficult part about fighting is the training, because believe it or not, the easy part about fighting is fighting.
To achieve victory, he knows he must repeat steps he has taken many times before.
Around a month before the fight, the only thing I think about is just training, constantly training. I enjoy it, but you know, it gets sometimes boring because it's just constantly repetitious, over and over, same thing, over and over.
Snap, you threw like that, there you go.
Trainer Kevin Rooney's unique methods have produced results in the ring.
Well, the purpose of the slip bag is to get the fighter moving his head, to get him in the habit of moving his head correctly. Your right hand, left hook, right hand. Now give me 1-5-1. We use a number system where I call out the different numbers for the different punches. You know, 9, 10, 11. You know, body, head.
When Kevin tells me the numbers are 4, 5, 6, I know exactly what they are. I don't even have to think.
But it is at times difficult to get boxing off his mind.
80% of the training is all emotional. I try not to think about the fights, but usually I always think about the fight in my mind. While I'm in training, I would dream about the fight. And I always dream that I lose, and it's very scary. Oh my God, what am I going to do now? And it's funny, when you dream you lose, you wake up, and you wake up thinking that you lost. And it's scary.
But when Mike Tyson entered the ring against Larry Holmes, he wasn't scared. He was angry. Angry at his opponent, who had openly attacked his character in the press.
I'm going down to history, not Mike Tyson. He go down to history as a SOB. If he do happen to win the fight, down the line, he's going to destroy himself.
Mike Tyson, however, would do his talking in the ring.
Round one.
I called Larry Holmes from my home, and he said that, Ray, I would not run for Mike Tyson. Which implies he's ready to exchange punch for punch.
Ray, I have to ask you, Eddie Futch said anybody with an iota of tactical wisdom would go after the body and take away Larry Holmes' legs. Agree?
You notice, exactly, but you see what Larry Holmes is trying to do. He's trying to use that reach advantage. Keep that stiff hand out there and not let Mike Tyson get his punches on. Again, we see Mike Tyson not throwing punches this time. We'll see a lot of tying up from Larry Holmes, or we should see a lot of tying up.
And Holmes does work the body, rather Tyson works the body early.
Again, Larry's preserving those legs. He's not doing a lot of dancing, a lot of moving, but you need to see more jabs. He's keeping his man off by extending a stiff left hand. Tyson's having a few problems here, not being able to measure Larry Holmes. And I think that's what Larry Holmes has in mind, to try to frustrate Mike and make him run into him. I think Mike Tyson should pick up the pace. He's fighting Larry Holmes' pace. What Tyson has to maintain is his composure. He can't get frustrated. Those are the kind of shots that create a lot of damage.
Holmes is complaining about a low blow, and I think he was right. Joe Cortez says keep him up to Mike Tyson. That was a big right hand. Best punch of the fight.
Followed up by another good punch right after the bell.
Keep your knees bent and defense tight, but keep your balance. Working behind a good hard jab.
Big one, big one, big one, big one. Big one. All right, Big Jack.
Another one. It was Customato who said that sometimes a great old fighter who appears to be shot can pull together one big effort.
Look at Larry Holmes.
Larry Holmes is
look at
trying
the jab.
It right here.
Look at the jab. It's starting to stick out and snap.
And the crowd is really into this. Has been from the opening bell.
Look at the jab. Larry hands it down. He's popping the jab. Watch. Listen to the crowd now, Barry. It's fascinating how they change all of a sudden.
I seem to hear that same kind of reaction, I think, in another fight out in Las Vegas not too many months ago.
Oh, yeah, people changed their mind because all of a sudden, Larry Holmes is putting up a pretty good fight.
Well, we talked about the fact that Holmes one day said he would jab and the next day said he'd use his right hand and an uppercut. He's done both.
Larry got hit by a left hook, Barry, because he stood straight up and wasn't moving and he didn't have his hands up. And that's going to happen time and time again. He cannot afford to do that. Like here, for example, he must tie his man up.
That was a right hand, and down goes Holmes from a crashing right hand.
The old Larry Holmes would always get up and fire back. But he's in against a guy who is a tremendous finisher.
What?
And down he goes again from another right.
There's a full minute left in this round.
Larry trying to clear his hands while he's walking around. What he needs to do now is either tie his man up. He can't move because he's not steady. He needs to just hold on.
It will take every bit of savvy that this man has. Tries to fight back. Still 40 seconds left.
He's still on Queer Street.
And took another big right hand. 30 seconds left. Tyson just looking for the one shot.
Well,
seconds left.
Tyson still has to be careful because Larry's, oh, that shot, that's
huge
it.
Right hand.
That should be it.
And down goes Holmes, and that's going to be it. It's over. That's all.
The torch had been passed from the old king to the new king of boxing. Mike Tyson didn't realize the extent of his worldwide celebrity until he came to Japan to defend his championship against Tony Tubbs. When he arrived, the reception was overwhelming. In any language.
So I really would like to thank you graciously to invite me to your country, and I look forward to giving you a good show. And if there's any questions you'd like to ask, I would like to gratefully answer them. No one speaks English.
His fans were everywhere. The eyes of an entire nation were focused on this new age samurai.
Mike Tyson, sexy, I think.
Giant. He is a symbol of the United States.
For Tyson, this was something entirely new.
I feel like I left Earth and went to another planet. I never experienced anything like that before in my life. Around a bunch of people just surrounded around me. I'm so excited to just be around me. Experience, I don't know if I will experience again. I feel everyone should know who the world champion is. And in my mind, before I ever traveled to another country to fight in a world championship contest, I thought, yeah, everyone should know the champion of the world. But God, man, I would have took second thought if I knew it had been like this.
The objective was to capture the hearts of his Japanese fans. The target, Tony Tubbs, who at 244 pounds thought his bulk could stand up to Tyson's muscle.
The startling hand quickness that Tubbs brings, startling partially because of the shape of his body.
Well, here with Tubbs, the uppercut, I also know it's the uppercut of Mike Tyson. He's able to throw the same punch twice, under and over.
Tyson missed with the left hook. Earlier he had landed a wicked right to the kidney.
Look for a looping right hand by Mike Tyson, because that's the punch I see that Tubbs is vulnerable to. He keeps dropping that left hand.
1 minute to go in round one. Tubbs landed a left and ducked away effectively. You know what to do, champ. There you go. There you go. There you go. You know what to do, champ. Speed, baby, speed. Come on, sweet. Sweet.
What Tubbs needs to be doing now, he needs to throw two and three jabs to kind of break the rhythm of Mike. Because what's happening, Tyson's starting to set up. You need to break that rhythm with a jab.
Tubbs throwing the uppercut. A lot of people think he will have to be effective with that punch because Tyson comes in constantly.
Well, Tyson also lunging with an overhand right there. And that's one of the mistakes he makes.
10 seconds to go in round one. One punch after the bell, and now Mike Tyson returns to his corner.
I thought Tubbs fought a very effective round. I gave him the round. He landed some hooks, and he went to the body as promised. Remember, he told us that nobody has gone to Mike Tyson's body so far.
Okay. Second round. Second round. Okay. Second round. Round two.
The talking in Tubbs's corner was done by trainer Odell Hadley. So now Hadley and Rooney have had their minute, and round two begins.
Tubbs keeping that right hand up because of the left hook of Mike Tyson. But also, you notice now you see a much more relaxed Tony Tubbs. So now his punches are being more fluid.
Look at Tyson with the rapid-fire three jabs in a row. Something new within the past year.
Well, Tyson is starting to improve each time he steps into the ring. But what I see here in Tubbs is pretty much trying to get range so he can drop his right hand, because in this corner they told him to drop the right hand. The left hook lands, but he needs to come back with the right hand. There's the right hand, Jim, I spoken earlier about. You must give Tyson angles. You can't remain stationary. Hands must stay up and stay out of the corners.
But indeed, Tony acknowledged in talking with us, Ray, that you couldn't finesse Tyson completely. You have to be willing, as he said, to fight him.
Well, you saw that double punch with one hand. Sort of a bolo-type punch. And those are the type of punches that do a great deal of damage, because the body shot, then the uppercut. Raises the chin up, and then the left hook comes into play.
Good uppercut by Tubbs inside. Snap Tyson back a little.
Both feet together, and it's easy to be knocked down or knocked off balance. He's trying to use his additional weight.
Coming up on a minute to go in round two, Tony Tubbs so far appears in no way intimidated by Tyson's fury, as have so many of his opponents.
Good left hook, good combination by Tubbs. Open up. Get inside! You know, Tubbs just trying to gain respect, and I think he's done that.
6-2. Good left by Tyson. That's real.
Those hands must be kept up higher. And again, like I stated earlier, Jim, I don't think it's a good idea to exchange punches with Tyson. Good body shot, but you need combinations then.
30 seconds left in the round. Both fighters have had their say here.
I couldn't tell whether or not the punch hurt.
Tubbs is hurt. Tubbs is hurt badly. It was a left hook.
And it's over. Odell Hadley has jumped in the ring. The fight is over.
This was a man who had picked himself up from the mean streets of the city to stand at the pinnacle of his sport. This era belonged to Mike Tyson.
So there you have it. I hope you enjoyed taking a look back at my career. And believe me when I tell you, the best is yet to come.